And so, let me just get this right. And so in terms of chairing this panel, we have Cyree, who's a writer and librarian living in New York City. His first book of poetry, Slingshot, will be published by Nightboat Books in 2019. His work has recently appeared in the New York Times and has given speeches and lectures at the White House, the Whitney Museum of American Art, and the University of Pennsylvania. We have on the panel as well Marcelline Mandeng. Marcelline is a Cameroonian-born artist based in Philadelphia. They're using their body as a primary medium and subject alongside video, sound, and sculpture to create ephemeral and surreal installation artworks. Kiyan Williams is a multidisciplinary artist from Newark, New Jersey. My old state.
Oh, beautiful.
All right, New York. As I said earlier, I came from New Jersey to New Mexico. And Kiyan works fluidly across sculpture, performance, painting, and video. Kiyan's honors and awards include the Emergency Fellowship at the Hemispheric Institute for Performance and Politics at NYU, the Astria Foundation Global Arts Fund, Stanford Arts Award, and the Gates Millennial Scholarship. And we have Ras Mashramani. She's co-founder of the Around the Way DIY Sci-Fi Collective, Metro Polarity, inspired by the collective action of the Occupy Philly movement. Raz had a vision that a new form of sci-fi would emerge, one that is active, accessible, and grown from the block. And I'm just really looking forward to the conversation. Take it away.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for being here for Creative Black Futures. Thank you for the Family Stone for giving us funk, futuristic funk.
Yes.
Dang.
Bless up.
So humbling to come after y'all today. So we're all going to do our separate introductions. I'll start with mine. I have some opening questions, but this will largely be a conversation between the panelists. So you can get an idea of what kind of futures for Black people are coming down the pike as imagined by artists and writers and creatives of all kinds. So I know that y'all are all into that. So, you know, we'll get into it. So as a disabled Black person, particularly somebody living with systemic lupus erythematosus, a serious illness of the immune system, it has been difficult for me to imagine the future. As apocalyptic weather events become more commonplace, as medication becomes difficult to access, as institutional exploitation holds fast and rest remains a commodity, it can be nigh impossible to imagine a future for myself. I live with the knowledge that even if I was able to survive the hurricane, Du Bois's comet, or just the slow decline of arable land on the planet that I adore, the medication I rely upon to stay alive would probably not be available to continue my existence much longer after that. Even if I stockpiled my hydroxychloroquine, azathioprine, prednisone, these medications require chemicals that the earth makes available. I know that my disabled lovers, siblings, friends, and comrades could expect a similar fate, and in many cases, a swifter death than I. Hospitals and prisons, where so much Black and brown disabled life occurs, are very rarely evacuated. Escape plans for residential facilities are a low priority. When these facilities lose power, my people die. We saw this during Hurricane Katrina. We will see this again and again. It is no secret that Black life on Earth is disabling. It is no secret that Black and Indigenous people and people of color are already living in the future of the Earth with an increasingly unlivable climate. And yet there may just be hope for us. There may be still joy to come. Dr. Sherry Wells Jensen of Bowling Green State University in her 2018 presentation to the International Space Development Conference said, our disabilities may in fact be an advantage in the process of reaching more habitable planets. Our neuroplasticity can be weaponized to compensate for the abilities we do not possess. Dr. Wells Jensen notes that lighting systems are typically the first thing to fail in spacecraft emergencies, and that blind astronauts would be immune to the confusion such a crisis would impose upon the sighted. So too with legless astronauts squeezing into the tight holes in an aircraft. I have not yet thought of what power lupus might grant me, for I have not yet seen it, but I will wait. I know that Blackness and racism too has granted me with an empathy for other species. I trust that I would treat alien life forms with the compassion and respect that whiteness has denied me throughout my life. I know that as a trans person, I can witness and respect life forms with myriad manifestations of bodies and beings and reproductive habits. In short, Blackness has forced me to be creative in my solidarities to get by. I know that this creativity will extend to the stars if this country can find a way for me and my kindred to live long enough to get there. Who wanna go next? People got introductions?
Not an introduction.
Great.
Can you hear me? Can everybody hear me? Yeah, okay. All right, so I go by Ras Cutlass, Ras Mashramani. I have a lot of different names. I'm a co-founder of Mental Polarity. We are a science fiction collective that was created out of the Occupy Philly movement. We were really interested in exploring how our neighbors were experiencing their futures and their presence and how they were visioning their survival in the future and their livelihood and the way that they would experience joy in the future. So we put together some zines and we put together some books that would compile a bunch of different futures that people who don't always have access to creating those types of science fiction narratives would be able to have access to. So that's where I'm coming from in Philadelphia. Very much I believe that storytelling and narratives are ways to create real realities. So for us, science fiction is not just like a hobby or even an art form that is just for entertainment or for aesthetic purposes. It's an actual practice that we participate in Philadelphia and other adjacent communities where we could actually use that as a way to visualize, to create actual futures and create actual realities and worlds for ourselves where we can feel comfortable and feel joy there. So for me, as far as thinking about interplanetary, thinking about space, a lot of the planet work that I think about is here on Earth. And when I think about space, I think about housing and I think about actual land. My family has moved from different lands to different lands. And so the Earth is something that's very sacred to us and something that we're very tied to. And our people haven't necessarily had the luxury of a stable relationship with the land that they're from or the land that they love. Yeah, that's the space that I'm coming from. I do housing justice work back in Philadelphia. I'm a social worker by trade, so I also do mental health work. And I do a lot of the Afrofuturist work and a lot of science fiction work bleeds into my housing justice work where with young people, we visualize futures where youth homelessness is not a thing anymore. And so we explore things like the space race and we explore things like how colonizing other planets, how that idea is something that takes away from the amount of energy politically and intellectually that could be used to be building housing and building spaces that people who are marginalized could actually inhabit on this planet. So that's where we're coming from with a lot of this when we think about space.
Beautiful. Hi, friends. Can you hear me okay?
My name is Kiyan Williams. I'm a Black queer artist based in New York City. And like Ras, I'm also interested in thinking through and working through, mostly through a visual arts practice, the relationships between Black people and the land, in particular, the interconnectedness between anti-Black violence and ecological and environmental devastation. And then in my own particular practice, I unearth diasporic histories and transgressive subjectivity. I excavate residue from sites of loss within the African diaspora, slave castles and sugar plantations in the Caribbean and the American South, the last addresses of my great-grandmother who migrated from St. Croix, a small island in the Caribbean, to Harlem, New York in 1934, low-income residential buildings in West Harlem that have been demolished by commercial developers, to borrow the words of scholar Saidiya Hartman, I am intent on tracing an itinerary of destruction. And so working primarily in sculpture, video, and performance, I'm attracted to soil, dirt, and debris, which function as material and metaphor that are silent witnesses to the historical and ongoing dispossession of Black people in the United States. Some questions that I think about when I try and envision a future, or when I try and envision what it means to live on a hospitable planet, I think about and I ask, who has access to land sovereignty or to self-determine the lives that we want to live on this planet that we currently inhabit? I also think about the relationship between systems of extraction and exploitation and how those have been enacted on both Black bodies through the kidnapping of West African people in order to bring onto the U.S. soil in order to work the land under systems of forced labor, and how that is also intimately connected to the extraction and resources of natural, but to the extraction and exploitation of natural resources on the planet. And so one of my questions that I'm interested in and that I think my work tries to grapple with are, what are some alternatives to the systems of extraction and exploitation that exists under capitalism and Euro-Western imperialism? And what is Blackness as a technology? And as a technology, I mean, as a form of innovation, as a way of being in a subjectivity that has had to endure and survive and morph underneath systems of violence. What might that tell us about how to lead towards a future with a planet that is hospitable both in the resources in the land, but also in the people who inhabit it?
Okay.
Thank you, Kiyan.
So hi, I'm Marcelline Mandeng. I'm a Black trans femme based out of Philadelphia. And I was originally born in Cameroon, Africa, and I've been living in the U.S. for about 15 years now. So my entry into the United States is deeply politicized. I come from a family of political refugees. My father was forced to move, to flee out of the country because of his political views and his advocacy work. And so this is actually the first place he moved into after he left Cameroon. And so it feels like homecoming in a way, because I am walking the first place and the first land that my father stepped foot on when he came to America. So a lot of the work that I do centers folks like me, and specifically folks like me, so Black, queer, Black, trans, Black, non-binary folks who are typically under the age of 26, 25. I'm a firm believer in the power of youth, youth building, youth just sharing ideas, youth movements, youth empower movements. And so what that looks like in my work is, for instance, the home that I live I live with seven other Black, trans, Black, queer people, and we are at different points in our lives. So we have, in my household, we have folks who are self-taught genealogists. We have folks who produce music for a living. We have folks who are journalists. We have folks who are mothers, and we're all learning how to build this new paradigm where Black trans folks are not only able, but also capable of building a family by any means necessary and trying to move out of the space of struggling to survive and actually thriving with all of our respective areas of expertise. So the work that I do in my home is deeply spiritual. I make things like spiritual baths for a housemate who might be dealing with the residue of sexual trauma. So I will tailor a bath specific to that person's need, or I provide tools for folks in the house to deal with their mental health issues, or just create opportunities for folks to thrive outside of our city. So be it traveling for working opportunities, or just creating a platform so that we can be, we can have agency in how we decide to share our stories. I am also an educator, and I've done that for two organizations. One organization is New Voices for Reproductive Justice. It was originally founded in Pittsburgh by Black women and has since relocated to Cleveland, Ohio, and also Philadelphia. And the work that we do at New Voices for Reproductive Justice is we look at social justice issues and reproductive rights issues that affect the lives of Black women, femmes, and girls. And we are specifically targeting reproductive rights issues such as access to abortions, providing abilities for folks to decide how they would like to create families, whether or not they're ready to create a family. But the work that I specifically started doing in New Voices was thinking about the ways that we create opportunities for Black trans, Black queer, Black non-binary folks to raise families. So what does that look like for a person like me to conceive of a child, to raise a child? What kind of tools and resources do I have access to so that my child can move through the world fully able to be themselves regardless of whatever systemic oppressions they may face? And another organization that I work for as an educator is the Heinigman Learning Center for Project Home. So I'm an after-school teacher with second and third graders, and the work that I do there is it's both targeting some of their academic needs that they might not be meeting in schools and also providing opportunities for them to grow and expand their imagination so that they're fully functioning young people who can go out into the world and actually be well-abled, intelligent, wise, joyful bodies. And that looks like so many different things, both in the classroom and outside of the classroom.
Excellent. So I'm going to kick off the first question, but I'm hoping that we all have some questions for each other, especially based on our introductions. I think people are getting re-mic'd, which seems great because it seems like these mics were not optimized for hoop earrings. Think about it next time. Think about it in the future.
Right. A lot of hoop earrings on the panel.
Yeah. All right. Just wait until we have that good. All right.
Can y'all hear me?
Yes.
Wait. Can y'all hear me? Yep.
All right. Great. So my first question is for Kiyan. So as an artist who takes their materials from the earth, how do you think that informs your relationship to the earth fraternity and also the possibility of Black life elsewhere in the galaxy and beyond?
That's an immense question. I think I'll begin by saying that part of my interest in working with the earth, with soil as a material in a very visceral, embodied, and tactile way, as someone who grew up in the Northeast in a major metropolitan city without access to many green spaces, was to begin to cultivate a relationship with the land, one that was rooted in reciprocity and generosity, and not having like a fear of the land, because literally so many people I know growing up like are fearful of going into natural spaces. And like as Black folks, that's a really sort of loaded and charged experience. But I realized, or like in my own life, that I felt so deeply disconnected from the actual like physical natural land and resources. And when I think about my life and try and think through the various histories that inform how it came to be that like I grew up being so deeply disconnected from the land, I think about the fact that like, you know, my grandmother and my great grandparents migrated to New York City and New Jersey from the American South, from North Carolina and the Caribbean respectively, and mostly lived within agricultural communities and societies. My grandmother and her parents were sharecroppers, and they grew various crops within sort of the North Carolina region, and had such an extensive knowledge about the land, about when certain fruits were ripe or in season, about when weather patterns, different weather patterns would like impact like both their social worlds, but also their interpersonal worlds, and how to like protect and prepare for those kinds of things. And that kind of knowledge was lost during sort of the migration to northern cities in order to live, like mostly for like economic opportunities. And so my use or like my interaction with the land and my sculptural and visual art practice is both trying to mend that rupture and also trying to like develop a new relationship to the natural environment I've been thinking a lot about what a Black transcendentalism looks like. Mm. And by that, I mean like what it means for like Black people to have like transcendental, ecstatic experiences within the natural environment. And part of that is also thinking through the history of the transatlantic slave trade and movements, sort of fugitive movements through which runaway enslaved Black people would navigate the forest in order to self-emancipate, because the forest provided cover.
Right.
And so when I'm working with the land, I'm activating and thinking through these histories of Black people literally trying to free ourselves from a very dystopian present, mm-hmm. And actively living and realizing sort of I don't want to say utopian futures, but more hospitable futures that might be more welcoming and affirming of Black life. And so that sort of both those like social, political, and historical questions sort of emerge for me when I'm literally, you know, going to a former slave plantation and like unearthing soil and debris from that site and bringing it to my studio to create sculptures that commemorate those kinds of histories in forms of transgression.
Thanks. Yeah, that's so interesting. Like, I'm from 20 minutes south of Kiyan, and I'm from the woods. You know what I mean? Like, I am from the legit, I'm top of the Pine Barrens. And so, like, my relationship to land is so different. So it's always so great to think about how close the land is to the city and, like, the way that these divisions are a false dichotomy in totally. So many ways, and that like without the land around the city cannot function, right. And without the city, the folks around cannot have jobs. And so how those spaces are so symbiotic, but like mm-hmm. also seem so separate from one another. So thank you so much for that. Do you have a question that you want to ask someone else on the panel, or should I just launch into the to another question?
I mean, I always have lots of questions. One thing that sort of resounded when I was hearing everyone's introductions, was this idea that like to be Black in America already is a dystopian present. And so I'm thinking about using, if that is a point of departure, how might we reformulate like how we think about futurity or like sort of sci-fi imaginings of utopias? Mm-hmm.
I could take that. All right. So Metropolarity does a lot of work around kind of reframing science fiction overall, because science fiction seems to have an addiction to dystopia, which is this idea that like these really bad things will one day happen to us who have never experienced these certain bad things, like a climate disaster and not being able to be helped because all of the systems are down. And oh my God, it's a dystopia now. And that's not a dystopia for most other people in the world. Like that's a very real reality where, you know, in other countries that there are generators that whole communities are sharing, and they already know that they're going to have to share those generators, or they're already building their houses on stilts because that is literally the most ecologically sound way to build houses versus importing an American form of housing. This I'm talking about Guyana, where my family's from, and where people who are trying to build housing, who have moved to America or to other westernized places and are trying to build housing back in Guyana, they're thinking about like, I want to build something that looks like I made some money back where I came from, where I migrated to, where that's not even the best way to build housing in that place, because you have to think about the future. You have to think about the fact that your system of government is not going to necessarily protect you if a flood happens or if a hurricane happens. So like build smart. Those are things that people are dealing with right now and have always dealt with in the Caribbean in places that are wet. Whereas in this country, it's like, well, one day we will have to think of a whole new infrastructure because there will be a dystopia where we're all underwater, ignoring the experiences of people who are already living under those circumstances, and people who just always lived on the water. Right. It's not new to them, but it. Because certain people who feel like, oh, I have this certain knowledge and a certain way of living, these people are primitive for living on stilts, or they're primitive for living on a certain way. So like, Anyways, all that to say, I just really want to get away from the idea of dystopian versus utopian and just think about life and just think about reality overall, like, because reality for us in mental polarity encompasses sort of cyclical time systems where the past, present, and future are kind of collapsed onto each other, because that is how most other systems of time are in this world. They're not all linear, where it's like there's a beginning, middle, and end, or there's a past, present, and future, or there's a past history, and now we're going to shoot on into progress, into the future. The truth is, the history is cyclical. Civilizations rise and fall. And I think right now, where we are now, we are experiencing the falling, or at least the humbling of a civilization or an empire, where you're realizing like these narratives that have been built are not linear and they're not progressive. They're just narratives that we're living under. So as far as like another paradigm other than dystopia versus utopia, I'm just thinking about reality. Science fiction for us is building realities. It's a way to build realities. And so we do a lot of work when we do workshops in the community to like get science fiction from our neighbors. A lot of the science fiction from like Black and Brown neighbors in Philadelphia is not necessarily dystopian. It's like very like, this is what I want to do with my family or with my block. I want to build a block that's completely self-sustainable. I want to build a block where all the youth have jobs taking care of the elders and the elders pass on their wisdom to the youth and this, and this. It's like very practical blueprints for things that could happen in the future and could happen in the present. And for us, that's what science fiction is, which is a practice of building futures and kind of expanding our imaginations and kind of moving beyond city planning, like going to school, getting a degree in city planning. And that is the way that you build your city, or that is the way you build your community, instead using science fiction and creative methods to actually build communities is, I think, for us, like kind of a moving away from the dystopia versus utopia paradigm.
To quickly answer your question, I think that being Black is a science fiction, and this, our reality is predicated on just dystopian possibilities of just eradication. So we're constantly being pushed to confront death as Black people. I think it's something that first starts inside. So thinking about, you know, hereditary diseases that our families pass on to us generations after generations, such as maybe diabetes or high blood pressure. So it's also found in the food that we consume, you know, not having access to the most organic, healthiest food options. It's in the environment, you know, just dealing with systemic oppression and police brutality. It's in the ways that we give birth. So, you know, Black women have the highest rate of mortality when it comes to childbirth, and also newborn infants who are Black are more likely to die than any other infant. So it's kind of impossible for us to not be constantly faced with death in a way that I, as a Black body, move beyond the reality that I'm going to die in any minute is by imagining a future for myself. So thinking about the work of science fiction writer Octavia Butler, who literally wrote herself into history. She would write down every opportunity she wanted to accomplish for herself. She envisioned herself into the future so much that she died before she could accomplish everything she had set out to accomplish. And it's in books, like all of the things that she wanted to accomplish, all the things that she did accomplish. And another way that I imagine myself in the future is by referencing my past. So recently I started working with a Black genealogist who deconstructed my DNA to the level of my indigenous African ancestors. And with that research, I am specifically interested in the histories of African indigenous people that possess an element of queerness. So thinking about the Wodabes of Niger and their 7-day long ritual of Gator Wall, where you have the more masculine figures sort of painting themselves and adorning themselves and, you know, smiling gleefully as like a way to attract a mate, and it'll be a row of masculine figures for 7 days standing under the sun, just smiling, face beat, painted, and you have then a femme who picks out a male from the audience. And so if you think about how we view courtship in the Western world, it's very much like the more masculine figure chases after the femme, whereas like in Gated Wall, the femme gets to decide who she's mating with, and oftentimes these are femmes who are already married. And so once she picks a mate, the mate then has to steal her from her home at night. And then, so I think about Gated Wall, I also think about somebody like Queen Zinga, who ruled Angola during the 1600s. And she took over the kingdom of Angola after her brother couldn't do it. And she was a very masculine, very ferocious leader who ended up, she had a shaved head, she was very butch, and she ended up taking on many male lovers who she forced to become women. So she would just have all her male lovers parading around as women, and that was just something that you could not reject. So I'm interested in how my Black queer body has shown up in history, especially given that a lot of the Western world had me believe for a while that we didn't have a history, African indigenous people didn't have a history. So I look to those history to remind myself of what is possible in the future.
Absolutely. I think specifically as a Black person with a disability that's like very specific to Blackness, so 70% of people with systemic lupus are Black female assigned folks, and it's because lupus is linked with estrogen, right? So we find that a lot of trans feminine people might develop lupus if they're taking estrogen, for instance, because it's linked with hormones. So thinking about the ways that disability specifically is coded as dystopian, as necessarily dystopian, is always really concerning to me, because disability is only dystopian in a society that fears death, that has no way of reckoning with death or hardship. And additionally, who is unable to provide any kind of palliative care at a cost that people can afford, right? So one of the transformative science fictions that I always turn to is the movie Snowpiercer, where essentially the disabled people are revered because their disabilities are marks that they have fought, right? So in their society, there are lots of different people, mostly amputees, who they're like primary form of capital punishment is to, well, the background on Snowpiercer, raise your hand if you've seen Snowpiercer or if you read Snowpiercer. Okay, we have some Snowpiercer fans in the house. Wonderful. So essentially, Snowpiercer is a time where the government, not so far-fetchedly, cools the climate so that it is uninhabitable because it is so cold to counteract global warming. And so all of the survivors of Earth are on a single train. And on that train, it is divided by class. So people in the lower class are in the back of the train. People who are middle class are in the middle of the train. People who are upper class are in the front of the train and experiencing pleasure while others experience pain. And so frequently there are class revolts where people try to get to the front of the train and essentially form a coup of the front of the train. And so these folks who have formed these coups become amputees because their arms and legs are essentially frozen off by sticking them out of the train into the incredibly freezing weather. And so disability in that context is a mark of bravery, right? And so disability in the context of systemic lupus, of course, is a mark of trauma, right? Because anybody can have lupus living inside of them, but it needs a great trauma to bring it out, which is largely why Black women and Black female assigned folks are the ones who get lupus in the United States. And so thinking of that, what would a utopia look like for disabled people, right? Other than universal healthcare, free access to all medications, right? Immediately. It would also look like hospice inside of community, right? So building up our community is also ways that we can create a utopia. One of the things, I'm from Piscataway, New Jersey. And one of the things that people don't talk about Piscataway, New Jersey is that it was the site of a utopian project, a 100 year long utopian project started by anarchist Jewish folks. And so the legacy of that, right, is community schooling, free schooling, and also community farming projects, et cetera, right? is building communities that are livable. And I think that for disabled people, utopia is not so different, right? Like, we want to live in our communities. We don't want to be forced into hospices that are separate from people. We don't want to be hidden in hospitals, right? We do not want to die alone. And that is a basic human right, right? So I think that, like, the idea of disability as a worst case scenario for life on Earth as things become more dystopian is really a result of an inability to imagine communities where we can literally all live, right? From the tiniest child to the oldest person to sick people, disabled people, we need to create communities in which we can all live. And I think that that is a utopian future that we can start creating now. All right. Does anyone have another question that they're interested in asking folks on the panel, or else I can jump back into my list of questions? Okay, I'll jump back in. Okay, this one's for Raz. So it's no secret that I personally stand metropolarity. Use all, find a way, so many reasons to make me stand even more. And so I wonder what do you feel Black, a role do you feel that Black collectivity has in the creation of the future? And how will such formations make Black life on other planets more possible and increase our resilience if we remain terrestrial? I know that's three questions, but here we are.
That's okay. Okay. All right. I don't know the order that I'm going to address it in, but I will say that the first thing I want to say is that I feel very connected to life here on Earth. And it's kind of for a spirit, like spiritual reasons too, spiritual and ancestral. I feel like unless I'm invited to another land, I should not go there. And I feel like that very, very strongly. And I also feel like there might be some ancestral boundaries as far as leaving this land that I don't know what I would call them, rights or curses or something. I don't think that my people want me to leave this land. I feel like I'm very connected to this earth, and a lot of my spirituality is connected to the earth. And a lot of my intellectual life too. I think I grew up in a biological and ecological nerd, definitely. I was very interested into all the plant and animal life around me, even the little bits that I had in like Los Angeles County, where it's all covered in concrete. There's still lots of slugs and lots of crows and lots of palm trees and date palms and things like that. So I have a very emotional spiritual connection to this land and this planet on the one hand. And then, all right, Black collectivity. All right, so Black collectivity, so you were talking about how Black people have recreated and created culture and themselves over and over and over again in the face of the last, 400 or so years of, what we've been going through. And I believe very much in that energy and in that capacity. And if it's one thing that I have faith in, is that capacity to do it over again and to keep doing it over again. And I think that we're sitting here and we're doing it over again. And every time we have kids, every time we raise children, every time we educate people, every time we go to church and build with elders, like that is that same thing over and over again. So many of our institutions have taken over pieces of culture. If we're talking about music, if we're talking about fashion, we have been able to recreate whole worlds around our culture. And so I have a lot of faith in that. In a realistic, practical way, back as an organizer, back in Philadelphia, we use Afrofuturism a lot in our work. So I work with Rashida Phillips, who's part of Black Quantum Futurist Collective, a member of Metro Polarity. And she uses the space race to teach communities in Philadelphia about how Black people use the space race during the 60s to draw attention to the housing crisis and space issues where they were on land. So she has a project called Black Space Agency that she has enlisted the young people that I work with. They're called the Healers, Youth Healers Stand Up, to develop the youth arm of a people's housing, affordable housing platform. So our youth have developed this mechanism called visioning sessions where they ask groups of young people who are in foster care placement, who are coming out of prison, coming out of juvenile detention centers, if there was a future where young people were supported, housed, heard, and respected, what are the pieces that were put in place to get you to this future? And in that world, we literally put up all of our material in whatever space that we are, and we say, this is a space where adults have to give youth complete respect, complete attention, and they have to fall back and they have to be quiet, unfortunately. And if you have a problem with that, talk to the organizer, Rashni. But the youth have full space here. And that to us is a utopian project or you know, it's an imaginary space, quote unquote, but it is a real space. And if we didn't imagine it, it wouldn't really happen. And from our first visioning session, which brought together over 100 young people from placements and foster care and off the street, we came up with our first platform. And I remember so many adult professionals who work in shelter, who work in mental health institutions, not believing that we did it. And like, we have pictures of it. We have pictures of 100 youth sitting in a circle, raising their hands, looking eager, being like, my effing worker needs to listen to me because my effing worker doesn't understand how urgent this work is. This work is about my life, not about a paycheck, not about a nonprofit grant, not about a foundation. It's about my life. And there needs to be some urgency and pep in their step when they do my case. If we hadn't created a space where we imagined where youth could be respected and actually heard, then those youth wouldn't actually been able to, in reality, put those words into practice. And our platform, which we're acting on, we're working to build youth-led housing built by young people themselves. We're working to build co-ops, more housing co-ops in Philadelphia. Co-ops are actually much more sustainable, affordable housing options than affordable housing itself, because our government is trying to phase out affordable housing through HUD. I don't know if anybody knows that, but you should know that. ultimately, I believe in the power of Black collectivity because we've used it before, and I see it working now to actually build actual options, new options for young people and for people who need housing in general.
Thanks so much, Ras. Mm-hmm. So my last question is for Marcelline. And so your hybrid performance / installation, Fruits of the Ocean / Mother, considers the sacred place of water in the Black diaspora. How do you think that relationship could adapt to planets that may not have water, like our blue earth? And how might that love be transposed to other natural elements?
That's a good question. So like Rashni, I'm very committed to the earth and to imagining what a sustainable future for me and folks like me looks like while on Earth. And given that we're a body made up of, 70% water, I don't really imagine us surviving on any other planet, let alone any other planet that doesn't have water on it. And how can that be extended to other elements? I think that, like Octavia Butler stated, what makes us different, what makes humans different as a species is our intelligence, which is also our downfall. She said that because we're so intelligent, our intelligence naturally causes us to create hierarchies. And I think in a lot of our systems, we've sort of positioned material gain, material resources, non-human interaction above everything else, and we sort of have the reverence of the land and the natural elements at the bottom of the food chain. And I think it's exemplified in how much we've begun to worship technology as if it's like this divine, spiritual, cosmic tool for liberation. And I think that it's a way, our reverence for technology is a way that we're further disconnecting from the land that we walk on. And so for me, I also have questions about what it would look like for us to go back to models of living where we maybe modeled how it was like to grow up in a village, a small village where everyone was very much focus on just their family and home life, yet we're still involved with other families and other people where, you know, you could have a child that, you know, you raised at home, but the child was the community's child. And we weren't so distracted by our material pursuits, you know, our 9-to-5s or our just desires for material stabilities that we stopped paying attention to one another and we stopped paying attention to what sort of possibilities we're building with each other. So I I think our reverence of water as Black people is something that is that started with maybe like the nomos people or the nomos who are sort of these like celestial beings that emerge from the Sirius star, and they sort of fell from the sky into the water, and they were said to have been half human, half amphibian entities, so essentially mermaids, who populated a region of Africa that we now know as Mali. And it's a myth that is specifically tied to the Dogon tribe. And so when I look at the Dogon people, they're very much about the water. They built communities on water. They survive off of their relationship to water. And I wonder if there are other mythologies that exist out in the world that have such a like deep reverence for other natural elements beyond water, you know, and water is something that we still hold dear in our Black spirituality. We use it as a site for reflection, for purification, for cleansing, and it's something that is sacred to us. I don't know if there's another natural element like that, but like you said, you're working with dirt and land, so I think that's also something that we as a people need to have a deeper connection to, you know, the land that we walk on. How do we, you know, how do we own land as Black people? What does that look like when we own land? What kind of communities are we building on top of the land? Who is invited to shape the land? Is it people that look like us? Is it something that we leave off to other communities and we sort of coexist? Like, what does that look like to have the same reverence for water that we have for the land? So.
Yeah. So thank you so much, everyone. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you to all the presenters. Thank you for the Santa Fe Institute for bringing us. Thank you, everyone else. And we look forward to coming to the Indigenous Futurism panel next year.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.